just had a bit of a recap, and Matt will go over that again when he actually starts the presentation. So, I mean, for those of you who were here, essentially we went through the capitalist economic system and discussed some of the issues that we face today. And Matt really went through a lot of examples, and I'm sure he'll discuss a few of this, a few of these before he starts. And so today we plan to actually present the solution to the issues that we discussed. And the solution will be presented as the Islamic economic system. And so inshallah, we plan that this lecture will be a way for you to learn how Islam addresses some of the economic issues we face today. You know, tries to give you some motivation in terms of how Islam can be a role for social change. And Matt will definitely, you know, tackle some questions that you have. We have a Q&A section after. And I think Matt went over some of his bio, but essentially, as many of you know, so he's a senior manager at Deloitte. He's given many lectures on Islamic economics, you know, different types of lectures at Waterloo, where he was a lecturer. And so he's very well-versed in this topic. And inshallah, I hope that you'll find some benefit. I'd like to invite Matt to the stage, inshallah.
Assalamualaikum again. Khair for Ahmed and Muslim Commerce. Surprised at how fast they got the video out last week, which is quite impressive. And you know, well worth it immensely for all the team effort that goes into this. I know I used to organize events, and it's quite a bit of work, so well worth you all for this effort. So just beginning with the recap, the last lecture was called Disaster Capitalism, or Capitalism is a Disaster. And the reason why I picked that title was that concept of disaster capitalism is the idea that capitalism is a good capitalism and is a bad capitalism. We just need to fix a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and we're fine. But actually, with the conclusion that I left people with is that that capitalism is a disaster. That it's systemically and its core beliefs and its core practices is what is the source of the problem, right? And what we focused on last time was this idea of production. So production being the primary economic problem, you know, GDP. Measures, produce, and you know, everything will be, and that's the way the capitalist system does its focus. And then what we discuss is how it's destroying the ecological system through, for example, something like the tar sands, and we looked at how when these toxic lakes, when the tailings ponds, when they flood and break, how they affect. And we also looked at how it doesn't really meet our needs. It's not really producing what we need, and it's producing what we don't need. And then finally, we looked at the financial crisis and how, you know, as we know, the banking industry was the heart of that, and the bad bets that they made, as well as the whole concept of banking itself is problematic. So we'll kind of look at how like what is the solid solution later on. So in terms of how we wanted to discuss this topic, obviously it's. I have about an hour to communicate this. There's a lot more information to that. So, you know, we can handle what we can in the Q&A, but just in terms of how much I can cover. So first, I wanted to look at Islam as a comprehensive way of life, and because often when you discuss this topic, especially with people who are trained economists and even non-Muslims, when you talk to them about Islamic economics, one of the things they say is Islam left wing or right wing. We look at the role of the accountability mindset in terms of Islam. And then we will look at what's the correct way of looking at the economic problem, which is distribution, as well as cover things of societal thinking, ecology, as well as how do you end up with a society that enables entrepreneurship, but without the ills of capitalism. So Islam, a comprehensive way of life, is just an agricultural menu from Islam Spain. So what So is Islam left-wing or right-wing? So some people say, you look at some aspects of Islam, so you know, communism is a left-wing, the idea of state ownership for everything. And so they might look at the following hadith, which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he said, there's no exclusion except for Allah and his messenger, meaning that there is a concept of public protection. So like, for example, waterways, roadways, these things are publicly protected. So there's this concept of public. Someone would say that Islam is left-wing. Other people might look at the following hadith, and it says, a man came and said to O Messenger of Allah, fix prices. He said, rather, Allah reduces and increases. So meaning the prices, you don't intervene to fix the prices. So the best way is actually none of the above, right? So Islam is neither left-wing nor right-wing. It's a unique system that has its own way. And what I've sort of, over time, trying to explain this, what I've settled on is it has a policy approach rather than, these kind of extreme approaches of state owns everything, or the individual privatization for everything. So for example, the ayah that's behind me is that Allah permitted trade, but he forbid it. So the commercial activity is what's regulated. So you're allowed to trade, but you're not allowed to, you know, rent money. So this is the how I'd like to summarize that. I think the big thing is the accountability mindset, because that permeates through the whole economic system, and you can't have you can't really understand the economic system outside the accountability mindset. And so let's just revisit the capitalist mindset in terms of what it produces, right? So for example, the capitalist mindset is based on the concept of freedom, and you know, man is free because they have the problems with the church, so they threw away the church, and so they said we can do whatever we want, so we're free to pursue our happiness and pleasure. And the quote there that I have there, just a reminder, is that the government's primary function is to protect the wealthy, so because their freedom of ownership is what must be protected. So what we covered last time was about AIG and how it got bailed up billions and billions of dollars. So when they got their first slab, $85 billion of bailouts, does anyone know what happened to them, or what did they? One of the ways they used the money. They went here. They spent $440,000 there. Luxurious resort. Just to give you an idea where they spent the money, they spent $200,000 on rooms, $150,000 on food, and $23,000 in spa. And down there in the red, you see that's how much they spend on spa is the average per capita income of an American citizen. So that just tells you like how much extravaganza they went through. And even the politicians who probably were bankrolled by a lot of these banks, they couldn't hide their outrage. They say that, you know, basically when these people while they're being bailed out on taxpayer money, they were just having, you know, a big party for it. So we must reflect on the kind of the values that kind of enable this kind of behavior, right? Because it's you know, on the one, you know, the society, its goal is just to maximize having fun. You only live in this world. This is all there is. Have the big party. You know, it's better to, the focus on the dunya is what's something that drives the aqidah. And so the question you have to ask yourself, is it really something obscene, or is it something that people actually envy? And there was a scene in The Wolf of Wall Street, which is a film about the whole banking industry, and where the protagonist in the film, he's angry at being portrayed as the Wolf of Wall Street, but to his surprise, they're trying to break down the door to work for him. And so it's based on his life story. It's his autobiography. So this is what happened, and this shows you that he was portrayed as this monster in the article, but then at the end of the day, these are really the values that are prized in the society. I mean, in sort of like the rap lyrics and in that kind of genre, right? Get rich or die trying, right? So we can contrast this to the accountability mindset, and what happened was when Umar bin Abdulaziz, when he was the Khalifa, what happened is someone came to ask him a question, and he said, before the person started talking to him, he said, you know, is this a personal question, or is this has to do with state affairs? And so the person said it's a personal question, and he was kind of surprised. So then what Umar ibn Aziz did was that he put out the candle and picked up another candle and lit it, right? And the reason was, he said, the first candle was paid using state funds, where the second one was paid using personal funds, meaning he didn't even want to waste that much resources for he saw that as waste, right? That, you know, that's how accountable he was for the resources, right? And this links to the hadith where in Muslim, where it says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that verily Allah will ask him about what he trusted them with, that the rulers and are accountable for everything that they have. So even a stick of candle is internalized. So why did these rules inspire compliance? And it's really because of the thinking in Islam that a part of belief is based on conviction and thinking that you're, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in numerous ayat in the Quran asks us to reflect and ponder, right? And it's interesting when you look at, when you connect this to the financial crisis and when you look at the bailout and what Greenspan, when he was being grilled for his role in destroying the economy, he says, we cannot expect perfection in any area where forecasting is required. We have to do our best, but not expect infallibility or omniscience. Who's infallible and who's omniscient? Exactly. So what he's saying is that I'm not God, right? Like they treat him, you could argue that they treat him like a God, but he's not, he's saying I'm not God, right? And the other thing in the quote is that he says not our best. And what is the best? The best led to the greatest economic downturn since the Depression, right? And I'll show you a slide, sort of the real ramifications, right? Because this sometimes is like, you know, again, is that individualistic kind of perspective when you're discussing this kind of these kind of ideas, especially with people who are pro-capitalist. It's like, you know, it's just trial and error, we'll figure it out. Well, what about all the people that lost their jobs? Like, think about the families that broke up because of the great of this downturn, and people are just became homeless and things like that, right? So when he says that we have to do our best, This is the problem with human beings trying to create a system. It's doomed to create havoc and failure for other human beings. And even when you look at when I talk to people about even the concept of something, a concept like we take as Muslims for granted, which is the concept of farz, the obligation. If we think about, you know, if someone told you, a human being told you to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and do a physical routine, would you listen to them? If someone told you to stop eating during the July sun hours, would you listen to them, right? It's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the creator, who can tell us how to do these things, because he's objective, he's all-knowing, all-powerful, fair and just. And that's why when discussing the Islamic economic system, it's critical to always explain this aspect of Islam, because you can't understand how the system works without understanding the belief structure that drives it, and why the people in charge of that society would be worried about a candle. Whereas the people in this society, when they're entrusted with $85 billion, you can't even trust them with that. They'll go wild spending it at resorts and on spas. So moving on to societal thinking and ecology. So in terms of societal thinking, I was talking to one of the brothers after the lecture last time, and he told me about this quote from Martin Thatcher, and I told him I'd put it in the presentation. So. Basically, this is the capitalist definition of society. The capitalists, they say, there's no such thing as society. Rather, they say it's just individuals, right? And Margaret Thatcher, she was a right-wing politician, prime minister in England, and she implemented, she tried to remove all the sort of the safety measures that were adopted in capitalism in response to the communism. So she's very right wing, and so her definition of society, she's just kind of explaining what we all learn in economics in terms of this definition of society. And it's really, it contradicts reality, and I'll go through some hadith and explain what the correct definition is, because Islam implicitly has the correct definition. So if you look at this hadith, which we all know, is that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains how the ummah and the community is like one body. And what's beautiful about this hadith, when you really think about it, when you apply it to society, is that when you look at a human body, it has individual parts. So you have a hand and you have a head, right? Both have their distinctiveness, right? The head is not like the hand, but can they live without each other? They have to coordinate and work with each other in a harmonious process, otherwise both are in trouble, right? So this is a beautiful hadith because it really explains how the society works. So you protect, there's recognition of the individual, but there's simultaneously recognition of how we have the whole. And another one is this hadith that talks about how society is like people like in a ship. And so what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he explained to us is that when you look at the limits of society, it's as if there's two decks on that ship. So there's one people on the upper deck and there's people on the lower deck. And what the people on the lower deck, what they want to do is they want to save the people trouble on the top deck. They just want to get the water directly, so they're just going to drill a hole in the side of the ship so they can get the water directly. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam warns us the people on the top do not stop them from filling that hole in the sun, then they'll all go down together, and if they stop them, then they'll all be saved. So in terms of recent events, when we covered it last time, what does this kind of remind you? From what I talked about last time, in terms of the talk, how do you see this kind of applicable to what we're talking about? Exactly, right? So it's that the rich people, they didn't, like, in a sense that those people, when the poor people took those loans, the subprime loans, they took loans that they couldn't afford, right? And the rich people, they abused that of them, right? And they knew that they couldn't afford it, yet they still gave them those loans, even though they knew that, like, later on they'd have to leave the house because they were counting on the increasing housing prices for them in terms of how the scheme worked, right? The housing prices keep going up, they can destroy all those poor people even if they couldn't afford it, right? But when the house of cards fell apart, everyone burned, right? The whole world, like in Dusseldorf, Germany, a whole bank went up in smoke. Iceland could not afford McDonald's anymore, right? Iceland, they couldn't import stuff from Germany because their currency was in a mess because they had got involved in the financial crisis. So it's a very applicable hadith, and especially when understanding the current situation we're in. And just to reflect on a couple of quotes from we talked about last time. So what I talked about last time was Harold Laswell. What he says is that we talked about the need for propaganda. And basically says, it requires more strenuous exertion to coordinate and unify than formally. And then Edward Bernays says, the conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important and integral element in a democratic society. And so what these people realize is that their definition of society, which Margaret Thatcher actually claimed, and is a sort of Capitalist definition of society, what they realize is that this contradicted when they wanted to try to get people going in the same direction. And specifically, these guys came up when they wanted to organize the American society to go to war in World War I. Right? Those people didn't want to go to war in World War I because they'd be fighting their cousins, right? Because most of them were Europeans, they were immigrants. They didn't want to go kill their cousins, right? And so what these guys said was that, well, we need to get the public opinion together. And that's where they realized that implicitly you have to work with the real definition of society. And what that is that we as human beings, we're not just individuals. We're bound together. As I mentioned, what bound us together, what brought us here together is effectively how the university system works, right? So in terms of what brings people together and what divides them apart is the system. So then the system and then it's thoughts and emotions, right? So when you think of society, like in society, people here think freedom is good, right? And you're on campus, so the, you know, having partying is good, right? These concepts are their thoughts and emotions. If you suddenly go start talking to people in your classroom about the Akhirah, you'll get, in terms of, you know, people kind of like walk away, right? Because we live in a secular society, so it's not cool to talk about the afterlife, right? So this is what we talk about, common emotions and common thoughts, right? So in terms of ecology, what we talked about last time was about how they feed corn to cows, and that corn is, the reason why they feed them to cows is that they grow in about, to the same size in about a third of the time. And in Islam, torturing animals is haram, right? So as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to the hadith, that torturing a cat is not allowed, and the woman who did it went to the fire. And then we can reflect on this accountability concept again about how Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, when he was ruling, he was afraid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would account him for a goat tripping in his domain, and I believe it was Iraq. He's mentioned specifically, how would I answer to Allah if a goat tripped in Iraq, right? And we can see sort of with the events unfolding in Iraq now, with the Americans invading, that there's not even the concern for people, let alone animals. And this is, again, based on the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he explains that there's a reward when you take care of any animal. And we don't actually have to go that far in history, is that even now in Turkey, for example, when they go to the mountaintops in terms of feeding the birds, and this was a practice actually started by Umar ibn Abdulaziz, may Allah be pleased with him, may Allah have mercy on him. He says, go to the, distribute the seeds on the mountaintops and do not let the birds die of hunger in a Muslim country, right? So this kind of shows you that how this concern for animals, and this, again, it goes back to that accountability concept. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the ayah in the Quran, they tell us of something, it motivates action and concern. Also, with this aspect, no harm and no harming. So these toxic lakes of that we saw with the tailing ponds, whether it's the tar sands or the Mount Pali disaster, you know, this is not allowed. And something to be clear is that, you know, you might say, you might get the excuse that this is not possible, that we have to do it this way. It's actually not true. You don't have to use toxic chemicals to manufacture things. There's a company called Ion Eco out of Ireland, and they can build computers that are free of harmful chemicals and toxicity. And these computers are designed to last 3 times longer, as up to 10 years, and they use a bit less power, right? So the reason why that so we have to ask ourselves, like, why are we looking into these kind of manufacturing practices that are free of toxins? It's because there's no will, because it doesn't matter, right? This is just about production. That goes back to the capitalist way of looking at the problem, and instead of the proper way, which is to have concern for society. So this is what I was talking about in terms of that. This was the 10 cities that sprung up in the wake of the crisis. As many as 50 people were coming a week, and it built up to 1,200. And this was actually featured on Oprah at the time, because it was a big scandal like this with this financial crisis, sort of what happened. And that's what I was talking about earlier when I said about Greenspan doing his best. This is the result of him doing his best. This is the result of human beings doing their best and thinking they can solve the problems of economy, right? I believe that it was broken up by the police, as we saw with Occupy. Same thing, Occupy was dismembered through police action and spying and surveillance and that type of thing. So it wasn't, some people say Occupy fell apart because they lost interest and all that. That's only half the story, or even, and as they say, half the truth is worse than a lie, right? And so same kind of things is here. You just don't hear about it when the police get involved with these types of things, unless there's a real fury like we saw in Ferguson. So in terms of distribution, as we said, the capitalists, they say production is a problem, but the reality of human beings is that we have basically two sets of needs. One is that we have our basic needs, which is something that if you don't get, you'll die or you'll get disease. And then you have your needs on top of that, which is to access, you have your desires. Like, people want to have a big car and houses. That's a natural thing, and, you know, I'll talk about that a little bit later. But that's the way the correct way of looking at the economic problem is distribution. So the question is that we have these needs, how do we ensure that the society provides for those needs? That is the focus of the economic policy should be. So, and then we have to look at verse 7, where Allah Ta'ala tells us, in order that it may not merely become a circuit between the wealthy amongst you, right? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us is that there shouldn't be a 1% in society that has all the wealth, right? That's not how society should end up, but rather that the society should work to make sure that the wealth flows in society. And so there's a number of provisions like no riba and zakat, which I'll talk about and explain how it helps to distribute the wealth in society. So, and just to show you how bad things are, this is actually a picture from a slide I got from Lawrence Lessig. Anyone know who Lawrence Lessig is? He's a Harvard law professor who originally was trying to change the intellectual property laws in America because they're very, very dysfunctional. If anyone was following the Apple and Samsung lawsuits, for example, like everyone's suing everybody. Do you know who makes a lot of money off Android phones? Which was the company? Microsoft, because of their patents, they make $5 per Android phone, and it's some people joke that they're making more money off the Android phones than their own phones, right? So, again, this is the intellectual property thing, so, and that's where Lawrence Lessig, he wanted to do that, but what he realized the problem was the money in politics, right? And so, what he did was, he was presenting this slide as a study to show how much the wealth has changed. So originally, in 1949 to 1953, the bottom 90% had 80% of the gains of that era, whereas the top 1% got 20% of those gains. And now back here, what you see is here, it's that they got 120% of the gains, right? And then here, the 90%, they're getting negative gains, right? Because of debt, right? Anyone know what's the significance? Why there's a sudden shift here in the 82?
I think it has to do with the gold standard going down and printing more money.
Reaganomics. That's when Reagan and Thatcher came into power. That's when they started implementing these policies. That's part of it, but what the bigger thing was was Reagan came into power and he started stripping away any of the social state because soon communism fell in 89, right? And so they didn't feel the need to keep up, you know, these kind of pretenses of social welfare in the society anymore. That's how it went. So this shows you this is what's not supposed to happen according to Islam. This is not supposed to happen this way. Also, the idea of trickle down theory is the idea that the 1% get rich and somehow the crumbs fall to the rest of us in society. Again, that's not true. So in 2007, the GDP was 13.9 trillion, went up about a trillion and a half to 2012. But then the poor also went up, so they went from 37 million up to 46.5 million in that same time span. So it shows you that this trickle-down theory doesn't really kind of work in practice. More GDP, more poverty. So in terms of what's specified in the hadith is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that the son of Adam has no better right than he would have a house where he may live, a piece of clothing, where he may hide his nakedness, and a piece of bread and some water. So this tells you what are the basic needs in an Islamic society that have to be attended to. And also, interesting thing here is this hadith here. Any local community, if there becomes amongst them a hungry person, Allah has nothing to do with them, i.e. the community. And so what it's interesting that in Islam is that a person's humanity is more important than private property, right? Is that if you're going hungry and you steal out of that hunger to feed that hunger, and then the blame is actually on the community, which is very different than the sort of upbringing we have in this society, right? When you see someone's poor, you're taught to believe it's their fault. They should pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, right? That's the kind of idea we grow up in this individualistic society, whereas Islam has a completely different view. Again, the societal thinking, right, that we're all in this ship together, right? So when you see a poor person, the society blames itself as opposed to blaming the individual, right? You'll work with them, like, why are they homeless? Do they have mental problems? They should be in the hospitals. Who's taking care of them? Who's there? Like, what happened to them, right? This is sort of how you look at a poor person as opposed to just kind of, you know, sort of like in your mind, kind of swearing at them, like saying, no, they should get a job kind of thing, right? This is sort of the right-wing capitalist attitude to have to the poor, whereas Islam has a completely different attitude to the poor. So, and then it's an important contrast that in Islam, if you're hungry and you take to feed that hunger, you're not punished. Whereas in capitalism, can you just go into Walmart and take steal food and then you're okay? Because that's the thing, is in capitalism, private property is more important than being human. So is there enough to go around? Because some people say this, you know, the scarcity. Actually, yes, there's plenty of going around. There's actually twice the minimum nutritional needs are met throughout the world. This comes from none other than the economists. That's what they. And this is sort of well known. It's like, is there enough water to drink? Absolutely, there's enough water to drink on the planet, right? It's just a matter of desalination, right? You just have to desalinate the water. You just have to have the will to make that happen so the people get the water that they need. And that takes me to my next point. Is there enough in terms of, you know, should we drink water or should we read water? And what I mean by that is water is used in the pulp and paper industry. So in Canada, 22.6 trillion liters of fresh water goes into the pulp and paper industry. 10% of that goes into magazines, which, so anyone know roughly how many people that could like service, like in terms of any ideas how many people could benefit from that water?
I don't know, 500 million.
It's 14.8 million people. The clean water that would give clean water to 14.8 million people for the entire year. So that's how much they need to drink, how much they need to wash their clothes, how much to just take care of themselves for a year, right? And only and the thing is that that would cover the 1.4 million children that die every year from drinking contaminated water, right? So just 10% of that water, if it was given to the right people, you would prevent those deaths. But what I want to realize is that what capitalism says is that people should read the water instead of drinking it. That's what it says, and that's what the capitalist system says. It says, if those people die, that's their problem. You know, this is what we just care about production. We don't care about attending to those people's needs. But don't we need to incentivize production? Like, if you remember from the speech what I talked about last time, the deputy governor of the Bank of Canada, Timothy Lane, he was saying that they've done all these radical things in the system is because they wanted to increase economic growth. So there's always this kind of understanding of to stimulate economic growth, right? And the reality is we don't really need to do that. Like, I mean, if you look at, you know, before capitalism in Turkey or in Egypt or in China, people built stuff. Like, people were productive. You didn't need the European liberal system to come and teach you to be productive. And more importantly, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us if the son of Adam had money equal to a valley, then he will always wish for another similar to it. Meaning man is inherently driven to acquire wealth. He has that internally. And I'll revisit this hadith at the end as a closing note, inshallah. So, moving on to entrepreneurship without capitalism. So, the reason why I put entrepreneurship without capitalism is that often when you discuss Islam, you know, again, people go into that left-wing, right-wing mode. So what I try to do is, within a few number of words, what I try to express how Islam is a completely unique system. That's usually why I do that. So people, you know, question that dogma that you've been brought up with, because either you have tyrannical socialism or you have free market liberalism, right, where you can be an entrepreneur, and et cetera, et cetera. And so what I position is that Islam actually enables entrepreneurship without capitalism and without the expense to society, as I will discuss. So first and foremost, that interest is not allowed, as you can see, but just to discuss it in a more, like, looking at it as sort of the consequences of implementing interest, if you will, is that interest is imposed regardless of the lender's ability to pay. This is the sort of the problem. As I talked about last time, that when the Babylonians practiced interest, they used to they set the debt record to zero anytime a new king ascended to the throne, because they realized this problem, right? That you can't just keep on practicing, you can't just keep interest going and going and going, right? Because it's not linked to anything. So if you contrast that to the profit sharing, so when you share, you have a business and someone comes in and invests in you and you share what comes out of it, it's something real as opposed to something just imposed artificially as a geometric sort of formula, right? Because the only consequence of that is that it'll eat into the assets, and they'll just seize the assets, as we talked about, that was sort of the theory behind the subprime world. So just to illustrate how cancerous nature of interest is that we should look at why Britain passed the Thalassen Act. So you may say, well, what is the Thalassen Act? What happened was there was a Swiss merchant by the name of Peter Thalassen. He wanted to invest 600,000 pounds in a trust. And that would compound at interest at 7.5%. So this would be a bond to the British government, right? So the British government would pay him 7.5% compound interest. And that would be divided amongst its inheritors in 100 years. So it was probably some risk management professional in the British government at that time looked at that and said, let's do a calculation to see how much we'd out be out by. And so they did a calculation at 4%, so almost half, and just half the time, right? And it would be bigger than entire debt than Britain, right? So that shows you how this grows like a cancer, like a virus, right? Like we saw that graph. The things that grow like that are viruses, right? And those viruses, if they grow almost at that rate, they'll kill you, right? And that's the nature of interest. And so what they did is that they actually, you know, limited trust to X number of years, and that's how they sort of dealt with that. Margaret Kennedy, she explains, just before I get into this, is that what Margaret Kennedy explains is that if someone took a penny at the time of Isa alayhi salam and they did compound interest, it actually, the amount of gold that you need to pay that off would have to be bigger than planet Earth to actually pay that one penny on riba. And what she, in her studies, what she found is that 80% of the poorest Germans, so this segment down here, pays interest at $1 billion a day to the richest 10% of the Germans, right? And so obviously in Islam, riba is haram, and its interest is not allowed. But just to explain how devastating and real these consequences are, is that in India, they lend interest at, they give loans at 36 and 48%. And what this has resulted in, farmer suicides. You may have heard of this wave of farmer suicides. So in 2009 alone, it's about 17,000 farmers killed themselves. And the total death toll from 1997 on this is about 260,000, which is Saskatoon. And it kind of gives you an idea of how devastating that. Imagine all Saskatoon wiped out because of something. We would look at it and say, question whether it should be legitimate or not. And that's the real consequences of interest. And then what Margaret Kennedy also explains is that 45% of everything you pay is actually interest. Is that when you buy a cell phone for $500, $225 is interest. Like if you look at the cell phone manufacturer and when they borrow money, and their suppliers that borrow money, and including as well as other costs of capital, including dividends, etc. So when you accumulate all that together, that ends up being 45%. So that shows you how the interest concept is a dead weight on the economy, and it's like it must eat into everything, just like taxes. So what about inflation? Well, in Islam, we use the bimetallic standard, gold and silver, and inflation is really caused by printing money. And obviously you can't do that with metal because you can't print metal, right? I mean, they tried the alchemy thing and all that. Yeah, so it does look so then moving on to public companies and stocks. So when you look at this concept in Islam, the way I like to approach it is to look at the corporation. And I'm not sure if you're familiar with the documentary, the movie The Corporation, which is based on a book. The premise of that movie is that they look at the corporation and see if it's a psychopath, right? So there's the World Health Organization has a checklist to determine whether someone's a psychopath or not. So for example, you have callous and concern for others, deceitfulness and other things, right? So they go through, in the movie, they go through this and give examples of how the corporations enables that. And really, the reason why this movie is really interesting for us as, especially as Muslims, and when we want to explain Islam to non-Muslims, is that, like, how did they allow this beast to be born, so to say? Like, what enabled them to do that, and how it came to that? What's the resolution, right? If you were to go to Occupy and you to tell them, how do we answer the concept of corporation, what would you say? So what it is in Islam is that where the corporations and the kind of the stock contract fails the Islamic requirements is that you must have a valid offer and acceptance. There must be real people in the company. And that's what Islam does, is that because when you give an offer and acceptance and it must be between two parties, it forces the human element to stay there, and that's what limits its ability to expand that. So like what the stock contract does is basically the corporation exists, it goes beyond its actual owners, right? And so what can help us to understand how this is wrong is when we look at a similar concept in marriage, right? In marriage, you can't, Khalid marries Khadija, Khadija can't just sell her contract to Munira, and then all of a sudden, Khalid is married to Munira now, right? So, oh, that's okay. So it really, because what it really highlights is how much we've been influenced by capitalist thinking, right? Because you know, when it comes to marriage contracts, we recognize it's a human relationship, and it's absurd that you can sell a human relationship, right? Like you have this relationship with this person, you just can't just sell it. So the question is you know, how is it that we came to think that this would be different for when it comes to partnerships, right? Going back again to societal thinking, if I partner with Muhammad, we're partners together, how can I suddenly just sell it to someone else in this room, right? And that's a consequence of that. But we can tie this back to the accountability concept, right? So if someone invests in these tar sands, and they produce this and they kill those ducks, from an Islamic perspective, would these people be accountable in the day of judgment? Right? Right? And we just remember what the Sahih brought up about Umar bin Khattab being concerned about the goats in Iraq, right? And about the birds in Turkey, like these concepts, right? Like this concept of accountability shows you how the public company contradicts that concept, right? And shows you that, because how can you be involved with a structure where you can't stop it from doing haram, right? Or stopping something that is against Islam. Also, short selling is forbidden. When a man came to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about selling something he was going to get the next day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade him from selling something he didn't own, right? So this is the whole concept of short selling. And if you remember that back in 2006, 2007, when there was a massive spike in oil prices, part of the problem was that people were just speculating on the oil contracts. So they wouldn't actually take possession of the oil. The oil would be sitting in the tanker, and they'd just be selling the paper on that, and they'd be driving the paper up. So in Islam, what would happen was that to sell something, you have to actually have physical possession of it, right? So you have to have possession of it, and then that's what enabled you to sell it. So this would cut into that type of speculation as well. So partnerships, partnerships are allowed in Islam, as I talked about it. But one of the interesting things about that is that you can be a partner with zero capital, right? And this is going to more to, I'm going to get to the solution and show how Islam kind of brings all these kind of points together. But it's important to recognize that Islam elevated the person with just skills to being someone who can be a partner just based on that, and he doesn't or she doesn't need capital. So what you end up with in Islam is that you end up with a real economy. All these kind of derivatives and all these shorts and long and stocks and credit default swaps, they just don't exist in Islam. So, I'll go that into a little bit more detail when I kind of bring it all together at the end, just to kind of clarify how that kind of results in entrepreneurship. So looking at zakat as asset redistribution, so what I did to illustrate how zakat works in terms of enabling the distribution of wealth is to show how regressive the actual income taxes are worth. And so sometimes when you talk to activists, they kind of bemoan how the corporations get all these deductions, right? They say, oh, this is unfair, the rich get all these deductions, right? But the real problem is, what is the basis, how you determine the basis of what should be taxed, right? So if you look at this student, this example is a little bit ridiculous because the student saved $500, right? As opposed to being in debt of $27,000. But just for the purpose of example, I have to make it work, and I'm sure you can see where I'm going with this. But so they saved $500. And then they made $40,000 in their first year, and they paid about $6,000 in taxes, right? And so their net savings after taxes of $4,800, and so the total wealth they've accumulated, if you take the $500, that is about $5,000. So when you do the percentage of taxes of the initial wealth, the $500, it's 1,200%. 1,200% of that. So when you take $6,000 and you divide by 500, it is 1,200%. And then of the accumulated wealth, it's 119%. Now, when you contrast that to zakat, because zakat, remember, you only calculate if you've had that wealth for a year. So that 500, it's only 13 bucks, right? It's only $13 that you $12.50, so then you can see that the person, what they accumulate here is almost 2.5 times that what they would have accumulated under capitalism. So what they've accumulated is $11,000. Now, what does that tell you about entrepreneurship? You want to start your own business, you have more access to the wealth you actually made, right? So let's contrast that to the rich, Warren Buffett. So now, this is examples a little bit old, but it's hard to find out how much the rich people make and how much assets they have, right? Because they try to hide that stuff. So Warren Buffett said he's taxed at 17.7% on the $46 million he made without trying to avoid taxes. Where you contrast that to his secretary, who pays 30%. So if you see, he paid about $8 million in tax just doing the math. And that, as a percentage of his wealth, is of $62 billion at the time, was before the crash, so it's gone down a little bit. 0.01%. Now, if you paid zakat, you pay 1.55 $1 billion, right? And you might say that's a lot of money, but you have to remember he's still keeping north of $60 billion, right? So it is a lot of money, but it goes to show that the student pays $13, whereas Warren Buffett pays $1.55 billion, right? And this is the this is again from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he told us the taxation base should be the unused wealth you have for a year. And that when you discuss this point with people from that kind of perspective, it kind of shocks people, right? Because it shows you that is a better ability to pay. Because when you're becoming an accountant and you take taxation courses, this is when they say, what is the ability to pay? Right? And they settle on the income as opposed to the assets, because most people have assets. So common ownership of mineral and energy resources, in this hadith in Abu Dawud, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that the Muslims are partnered in three things: in the water, the pasture, and the fire. So the implications of the fire is any energy resources commonly owned by the society, whether it's hydroelectric, whether it's gas, whether it's oil. So any of that stuff is commonly owned. And then also minerals are also commonly owned. And this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what happened was that a man, he gave a land to a person, and then he discovered later it had a salt mine in it, and then he took it back. So from that we understand that him as a ruler would, that we have to commonly own the minerals. So like copper, zinc, whatever, minerals are commonly owned in society. And a good way to think about that is that these are from the earth. It's natural resources, right? So how does it make sense for that to be privatized, right? When you're looking at it at a kind of, when you're trying to step back and you're trying to explain this concept to someone who's really locked in into this idea of to privatize these minerals because that's their mindset, I said, like, you know, kind of way to step back. Like, if you look at, for example, like, I remember I was talking to someone from Venezuela, and I told him about this hadith. And he was, like, shocked. He said, that'd be amazing if in Venezuela we would, kind of commonly own this oil, because it would be massive benefits for the society, right? Because, you know, it's just something that we've been passed on as to how to think of things. And the other thing is to think about special interests versus the common interest. Like, this concept of energy is actually a big issue. Right, from the environmental perspective, right, is that people see the fossil fuels as something that's contributing to the pollution, to the global warming, right? And they're looking at, how can we, get to like solar or wind, these types of things, right? But that's where these kind of these behemoth energy resources, they sort of get involved and they fund studies to show that climate change is false, or like they try to, get involved with that, and they fight any kind of legislation on that. And that's what happens when you sort of take away this discussion from where it should be. So moving on to the sort of towards the end, in terms of how does Islam enable entrepreneurship without capitalism? So if you look at currently in our society, you have owners of capital, the 1%, and then you have all these sort of different options that they can kind of invest in: stocks, bonds, derivatives, partnerships, options, futures, loans. These are their sort of array of things that they can invest in. Then, usually when it comes to entrepreneurship, they'll work with banks, and those banks will find entrepreneurs, and that's that kind of, it funnels it that way. Or they'll have companies, through the stocks and the public system, they'll have companies and people will work for those companies, right? So when you look at Islam, specifically from the entrepreneur perspective, and I'll get to the employee perspective in a second, is that what Islam does is that basically it eliminates all that other stuff, right? So now the owners of capital, they only have one avenue, and you don't need the banks anymore. It only allows one avenue for them to reach out to the entrepreneurs, and that's through the partnership structure, right? So remember what I said earlier about like how the, you can partner based on your labor, just your skilled person, and you have these talents and things like that. So the people who have capital have to find those guys with skills, because they want to give them the money as opposed to the people who don't have the skills, right? So and then of course, what I just want to clarify, of course, the people can own their own businesses, right? So where they get involved, through them and their family, etc., and they have their own employees, right? But what I want to show is that, for example, is like what happens to the employees for these sort of businesses, right? Is that what ends up, so for example, you have owner A and there's Kebab Co. And what ends up happening in that, over time, when you work at that restaurant, you become skilled, right? You learn how to make the kebabs, you learn how to run a restaurant. If you watch those shows on Food Network, where they do they do those, I don't know, there's like the operation, whatever, restaurant emergency. They show you how much work and skill and acumen goes into running a restaurant, right? Like you have to know how much to put on a menu, you have to know how to weigh the tables, and all these things you have to understand, right? So someone who understands that becomes quite skilled and they become able to run a restaurant. So the question that they have is that should they start their own business, right? And this is what will affect the wages, right? So when they're working with the owner A, this is the what owner A is going to be worried about is that this guy's going to open up his own kebab restaurant and then compete, right? Because you have to remember, there's other owners who are looking for those skilled guys, right? So what ends up happening in the Islamic system is that because partnership become the only avenue of investment, is that there becomes a what it could call for a war for talent, right? Is that people are hungry for these people who can run stuff. So because they have money, they want to invest it. There's no riba, there's no stock market, there's no derivatives. So the only way they can invest this money is to find other partnerships, right? I mean, of course, they give charity and things like that. And of course, that's encouraged in Islam. What I'm saying is that from a point of view, going back to the hadith about how the son of Adam will always want another valley of gold, is that this is how that energy and that desire to grow the wealth will be funneled in the economy. And what that explains is how the distribution of wealth accrues from the owners to the employees, right? And the employee might say, I just want to stay an employee, but at least he has or she has the option to go and start their own business, right? And go find someone else to do that. So in terms of societal support, like the other issues that are raised, you have the zakat. Zakat, as you know, there's eight categories, and three of those categories are represented here, like the pauper, the poor, and the indebted. And then you have the energy and mineral wealth. So that could be going directly into society in terms of, you know, Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, like he used to give, when the state had money, he would just give checks to people, so to say. So you can have direct, where the mineral wealth directly enters society. Or you can have subsidized energy, where you pay like basically nothing when you want to gas up your car for personal use. The other way you can use that common wealth is that common ownership is that it could go into like public goods, like hospital, education, and these types of things, where these things would benefit the society. And then the government is accountable to the people to make sure that they use this wealth for the right reasons, and then they can be taken to court. That's what common ownership. Because it's different than state ownership, whereas the state has more leeway in terms of using that. So you have other asset taxes like haraj and usher, which is based on, again, these are asset taxes. They're based on the productive yield of the land. And so, again, you can have direct supports if there's problems. But also you could give interest-free loans. So, for example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what happened, a man came to him asking for a handout, the zakat. And what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did instead was gave him an axe or a rope in some narrations and told him to cut some wood. And told him to sell it in a certain area, and then he told him to come back how he's doing in a year. So then the man came back in a year and said he actually returned the axe, or he repaid the interest-free loan in a way of saying, and then he paid zakat on his wealth. So in from how this would apply today is that you could have where you would give such a person who's looking for a handout, instead you kind of come up and sit with him and set up a business plan, the state would give interest-free loans, they start a business, and then they kind of check back in a year and see how they're doing, right? So this shows you how you can intervene that way. And the final point, what I wanted to bring up is to look at, and this is sort of hard to imagine, but is that there's easier access to capital, right? Because if you look at that, the fact that you've broken up the banks, there isn't these money trusts, as to call them in the turn of the 20th century, just accumulating and hoarding the wealth, right? Like the banks hoard the wealth, right? One of the consequences of the financial crisis was the credit crunch, right? Because what ended up happening, the credit crunch was that the banks couldn't trust other people's balance sheets, so they just refused to lend, right? Because when you lend, you have to have some kind of collateral, right? So they just refused to lend, and so they just hoarded the money. So they had all this money, but they just refused to put it in the economy, and that's obviously haram. But it shows you that the banks, they actually inhibit economic, they inhibit people from getting capital. So, but in this scenario, if you look at it, is that even if you, for example, just look at the zakat scenario where I showed you like how under an asset taxation system, the average person accumulates wealth faster. But even if you look at like people who deal in mortgages, right? Like if people didn't have to pay interest, how much faster would they start accumulating that capital, right? it would accumulate much faster if they paid off their house faster, right? So the average person in society, it'd be much easier to find people with money. And one of the things that is, and I think we're gonna cover this about like startups and things like that, right? The Muslim Commerce group. One of the things that people go to for money, first off, when they're having a startup, is friends and family, right? So this would be a much bigger factor in an Islamic economy, right? Because more people have access to that wealth. They are able to, it'd be easier to go to your uncle or your uncle's, you know, roommate or whatever, to get that loan you need to start up your business, right? So this shows you that, like, sort of gives you a more holistic picture of how all these kind of pieces of the Islamic economic system enable distribution of wealth, but simultaneously enable entrepreneurship. So some closing thoughts. Islam enables entrepreneurship, and I think one of the key things there is to talk about it is like how it eliminates the virtual economy. The money is real, the companies are real. There's none of this like kind of stock, like the stock. There's no stock market inflated valuations. There's access to the societal wealth of society, and there's limits on how the wealthy can not allowed to change these things. Like for example, wealthy can't just suddenly make real legal. They can't do that in the Islamic context. I wanted to close with this thought here. This is off Mother Jones, my wife sent it to me. So, and what it shows here is how maldistributed the wealth is. It's not the 1%. It's the 0.01%. Like that, this green here, that's the 0.1%. That's how much money they're making, and this here is the 1% down here, and we're somewhere down here, right? So, and the red part, right? So this shows you how maldistributed wealth, how contrary to Islam it is, and what you'll be surprised about that people down there, they're miserable. They did a study which said that the paradox of happy peasants and miserable millionaires. This group is mad that they can't join that group. That's their fundamental problem. So when you have $5 million a year, you're miserable. Right? That's what this study is telling you. You can look it up yourself and see it. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in continuing that hadith, where nothing can satisfy the eye of Adam except dust. Right, is that you're never going to be happy. If you set your sights on materialism, and that's the secular capitalist system does, you're never going to be happy, and that's the thing. And what the real tragedy is this system is making 99.9% people unhappy. That's the real tragedy, is that even if you're like pretty successful at buying $5 million, I'd be happy, right? But they're not, right? They're not happy, right? It's a miserable system. And that's where the next part comes in. And Allah forgives him who repents to him. Meaning that the real point is the akhirah. The real point is that it's to get beyond the dunya, right? And that's where that goes back to the fundamental purpose of life as we talked about at the start. So, just as my last slide here, if you agree, well, I hope we can work together to extend this discussion outside this session. And if you disagree, I hope you can meet me after so I can clarify what I said and we can continue this discussion on. And I'm really happy to take your questions now.
Stock investing and that kind of thing, is it completely not allowed, or is it?
Well, that's where it goes back to what I said about the problem with the. That's why I showed. Did you catch the slide where I talked about the haram and the company that's haram?
I don't think so.
Yeah, so what I talked about is like the tar sands. Yeah, so what I talked about here was the concept of when the company does haram. Like, the point is that if you invest in that company and they kill the ducks, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hold you accountable for killing those ducks? Right? And I contrast that to how Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, how he was concerned about goat tripping in Iraq, right? And so that's the question, is that what I was showing is that when companies do haram, the structure prevents you from intervening. Like, if you had a partnership, and your partnership, you and your partner, you were killing ducks for no reason, and not to eat them, but, you know, like, just to torture them for no reason, then you'd be accountable under the judgment, right? So the problem with the stock contract is that's where it fails, right? Is that the way it's set up, you have this divorce from the owners, the partners, and the actual activity, right? These are not, it's not set up in the way that enables you to fulfill your responsibility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, which is to enjoin the right and forbid the evil, right? Because you have to do that in everything. So when the company does any haram, even if it's, for example, like it's buys alcohol, you know, for a Christmas party, which is not on the financial statements because it's immaterial, because that's not a material part of its transactions, it's on your books on the day of judgment, right? Because that the concept of limited liability is something in capitalism, not in Islam, right? There is no such structure where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that, you know, if your business does haram and you know, you won't be accountable for it, right? So the way it's set up is I think it's,
yeah, my question was earlier regarding that partnership you created between the owners of capital and the entrepreneurs. Maybe I missed the point, but what is it that incentivizes that loan even more? Because in the capitalist system, it's the return with.
Oh, it's a profit sharing agreement, so they would get into it. So, for example, if you were a startup, it's similar to like the, it would be similar, very similar in the capitalist system, in a sense. Like, the profit motive is not haram in Islam, right?
Okay, so
right.
So you merely form capital, and I'm the entrepreneur,
yeah.
And I make a business, so we have an agreement at the beginning that I will return you this much profit, or?
Yeah, we sit up and sit down and like look at your idea and say, you know, I'm going to put, you know, X amount of dollars, and then you'd say, well, I'm 100%, since that is really good, and I can go to anybody. I have these many startups.
Right.
This is a success record. Oh, 70%, you give me, I'll give you 30, right? So we'll sit down and hash out, you know.
And that's the rule.
Offer acceptance, yeah, right. And so we sit down and kind of hash out the agreement and then do that. So yeah, profit sharing is allowed. And that's why it's an interesting thing, because Islam allows for profit and enterprising.
Right.
But it still does that in a way that safeguards society. Because the point, what limits us is halal and haram. Right, as our business has to operate only on halal means, right?
Right.
So for example, you can't wine and dine clients, right?
Right.
Right. So this kind of thing, or you can't exploit women, right? This
right.
is another kind of issue, right? So it's like sometimes owners, like people in restaurants and these other establishments, will hire attractive women just for the purposes of, you know, their beauty, so that people come into the restaurant, right?
Right.
Now it's not allowed in Islam. So for example, you could do that if you had restaurants. That's an example. Yeah.
So back to the stocks, are you saying that the actual like contract itself in principle is haram? Or are you saying that, like for example, theoretically there was a business who didn't deal in any like anything haram, and they were not, you know, doing any problems or whatnot, wouldn't you be able to buy shares for this?
Yeah, well, it goes back to the issue of the contract. The partnership is not on it's not a partnership of people; it's a partnership of money, right? Like what they teach you and like. In school is like what makes the corporation so good is that it'll outlast the partners, right? Whereas what Islam does is because the rules of offer and acceptance enforces that element is that if I'm no longer in the partnership, just like if I'm no longer in the marriage, that partnership ceases to exist. It has to, you have to have the human elements in the contract for it to be there.
But isn't when a company goes public, isn't it that they have like the shares that are then distributed amongst all the stockholders? And whoever has the majority stockholder or whoever has the majority shares, they'll be able to dictate like what's done with the company or whatnot. So isn't there still a like technically, if you have only two like shareholders, then it's essentially that's the definition of a partnership.
Yeah, well, so what I'm talking about is a public company where it's traded on the stock exchange, right? So where
yeah.
it's traded on the stock exchange, because like you could like we could like if we set up like for example an example that was here, we could set up a corporation in like. Private corporation, but we agree to operate on Islamic rules, which is offer and acceptance. But the primary difference is that the rights are driven by the person, not the money, that's what in capitalism, what drives the negotiating contracts is your number of shares and how much you've invested and how you set up. So for example, like the Rogers Corporation is that the Rogers A voting A shares, that's the one that is held by the Rogers family and the CEOs and other other people that are important, like politicians and stuff. But the Rogers B, which is what is sold on the market, is what everyone else is. They're non-voting, right? So it's like these things are set up to again concentrate the wealth in the hands of the few. But in practice, it's the way they set up the shares that determines the voting right. So it's that structure. It's not just because I'm in a partnership, like in an Islam, like if you and I are in a partnership, if we decide to break away, then we have to sell everything. That's the only way to we wind up the company, and then we part go our separate ways. Whatever assets are there, whatever is according to the agreement, then we sell off the assets, and then we go our own ways. And that's because it's not driven by how many shares I have, but rather just my existence as a person. Right. So technically, if you came in with $10 million and I came with $5, we'd have the same rights in an Islamic company. That would never happen in practice. But like from an Islamic perspective, that's how it works. So the contract is driven by your body, not by your money. Okay. Of course, like in the situation we're talking about, what would happen is that you would drive a harder bargain. Like you would take the 80% and the 90% of the profits, but we'd still have equal say in how at least the company stuff. Sure.
Can you just
clarify
system that
it ran in, right? So it's